So it is, I am Sharon Murphy in the Department of History. It is my privilege and honor to introduce Dr. Patrick Breen, our own Patrick Breen today for our Humanities Forum. Today's forum is being held in conjunction with the Reverend Cornelius P. Forster Making History Lecture Series in the History Department, sponsored by the Gladys Brooks Foundation. Dr. Breen has been a core member of the History Department for the past 15 years, give or take, teaching various classes on 19th century U.S. history, the Civil War, the Civil Rights Movement, slavery, African-American history, as well as DWC, and a colloquium on democracy in America, among other courses. He's published articles and book reviews in some of the top journals in the field, including the Journal of Southern History, the Journal of American History, the Journal of the Early Republic, the Virginia Magazine of History and Biography, the Journal of the Civil War Era, and Civil War History. And his much anticipated new book, The Land Shall Be Deluged in Blood, A New History of the Nat Turner Revolt, was published last year by the prestigious Oxford University Press and is already meeting with much critical acclaim. Slave historian Eva Shepherd Wolf called it the best book on Nat Turner's revolt yet written. And there's been quite a few of those, so that's a good thing. While the Library Journal judged it an original study of first-rate scholarship. The book has also been making a splash with the wider public, especially after the release of Nate Parker's new movie, Birth of a Nation, which chronicles, we'll see how closely, the Nat Turner Slave Revolt. As a result, Dr. Breen has been making appearances in LA Times, Slate, Deadline, the Smithsonian Magazine, on Rhode Island NPR. He's been also been invited to give lectures at venues as varied as Yale University, the Gettysburg National Battlefield, and the Minnesota Historical Society. He recently gave a talk at the Virginia Historical Society that was broadcast on C-SPAN, and you can go back and it's in their archives. You can go look it up, watch it. Today, he's going to be talking about the sources regarding Nat Turner's, is that correct? Yep, regarding the revolt and how they challenge us to think about slavery differently. And afterwards, I just want to remind you, after our talk and our discussion, we will have a very nice reception in the great room, so you are all invited to that as well. So without further ado, please help me welcome Dr. Patrick Breen.
All right. Thanks to Sharon for her fulfilling her instructions exactly, which is lying in very bold ways about me. Thanks also to you all for coming out here. The Humanities Forum is a venue where people can come together and discuss ideas. And the key to that is people coming together. So Friday afternoons, this is a great event. I really want to thank you guys for coming, especially the students. Please make a pattern of it, make a habit of it. It's something that we want to have happening on campus, and we want to have venues like this. Thanks also to Raymond Hain, the director of the Humanities, director? Yeah, okay. The director of the Humanities Forum. As Professor Hain's next-door neighbor and teaching partner in CIV, I have seen more than most how much energy is put into creating this program. He brought me into the project early, and I have been incredibly pleased to see how this forum has developed, creating a place for people to come together and listen to great authors. And I just want to mention some historians like Claiborne Carson, Woody Holton, Mary Bilder, Gordon Wood, and me. Good, you got the joke. Okay, yeah. People say it kills humor when you explain jokes, but anyone who's taken a comprehensive exam in history knows that group, there's one person who doesn't quite fit in. I'm taller than everyone else. I don't have a Pulitzer Prize in history like Gordon Wood, Woody Holton, or Mary Bilder. I haven't been tapped by Coretta Scott King to publish the papers of Martin Luther King, but I have written a book on a famous slave revolt, and this sets me apart from many of my colleagues who have come here today, even if, you know, they've written books and articles and several books. And perhaps the way that I can make most clear how special what I'm doing is do what my 7-year-old does when he needs to say how special he is, which is to start bragging. And so now I'm going to tell all the historians how my work is completely different from theirs. Since publishing my book, I have become something of a go-to for middle school and high school students doing History Day projects. There you are, Professor Breen. It seems every couple weeks I get an email like the one that came this Monday. Dear Dr. Breen, our names are Pavin and Dave, and we attend whatever school in Orlando, Florida. And we are celebrating National History Day by creating a website about Nat Turner. While researching about Nat Turner, we found a lot of interesting facts, which is great. I mean, you go, you research, and there's a lot of interesting facts. Anyway, when he was young, many considered him to be, this is my favorite line, to be surreal, in quotes. I've never seen that word before with Nat Turner, which is the only thing quoted in here, never. Because he could see events which happened before he was born. One day, Nat saw a spirit appear in front of him, and it told him, the serpent was loosened. Nat took this as God telling him to fight against slavery, and he accepted it. In February of 1831, Nat and his 40 or 50 followers burned down white slaves' houses and killed 55 men, women, and children. They later went to Jerusalem to seize weapons from an arsenal. Nat and his followers were losing the battle, so he ran away into the woods. He was later caught and hung to death. We would like to set up an interview with you because we believe that you have a great understanding of this topic and this slave revolt. And we would be able to accommodate your schedule to whatever is convenient. Thank you for your time, Pavin and Dave. Who needs academic awards when you got Pavin and Dave writing you fan mail? But I think Pavin and Dave are why this topic is important. Nat Turner is important to a lot of regular people, even people who might not read an academic book like mine. And my question is, what can an academic, what can someone who writes a book like I do to enrich our understandings of slavery? How can my formal academic arguments about slavery connect to and even improve the popular understandings of slavery? To answer this question, I want to talk about my favorite surreal guy, and that's my new go-to for him, Nat Turner, who led the most famous and deadly slave revolt in American history. And I'm going to do this by focusing on one of the comments he made. As Pavin and Dave wrote, and I do wonder, how much is Dave putting into this? I mean, get it from Pavin, you know. Is he like the inspiration? Hey, Pavin, you got to write Pat Breen. He's got a book on it. Or he's like, yeah, do whatever, Pavin. Anyway, Pavin and Dave wrote, Turner was a slave in Southampton County, Virginia, a county just across the North Carolina border in eastern Virginia. If you're thinking about Virginia, it's sort of between Richmond and Norfolk on that bottom line. Turner was born in 1800, and in the 1820s through 1831, he described a series of visions and prodigies that ultimately did convince him that God wanted him to lead a slave revolt. A strange appearance of the sun. It was described in the newspapers as the sun appeared, sort of a blue-green, which is certainly, I mean, it was worthy comment in the newspapers. In August of 1831, triggered the revolt. Turner and six men swept through southwest Southampton County, making their way to Jerusalem, the county seat. Pavin and David are the first to mention the burning plantation, so I'm going to have to do further research to find out how I missed that. But although that was a prominent feature of the Haitian Revolution, where we do have burning plantations, but they are right that the revolt led to the death of roughly 55 men, women, and children. The rebels did not, as they suggest, make it to Jerusalem, as our friends noted, but were defeated in a series of small skirmishes, and within 48 hours were dispersed into small groups that the whites routed. Whites killed, captured, or in certain cases, killed and then executed in revenge killings the slaves that they found. Pavin and Dave were right that Turner escaped with the forces that quashed the revolt, and he remained at large for a couple months. Months after the revolt, a correspondent to the Richmond Inquirer described the uncertainty in Southampton about where Nat Turner was. My own impression is he has left the state. Many believe him to be lurking in the neighborhood. Although no one in the white community knew quite where he was, Nat Turner was actually hiding near the original site of the revolt. But his hiding place was soon discovered. One night when Turner was away from his hiding place, a dog happened upon his stash of food. A few nights after, as Turner later recalled, two Negroes, having started to go hunting with the same dogs and passed that way, the dog came again to the place and barked, and on thinking myself discovered, I spoke to them to beg concealment. On making myself known, they fled from me. And that was the moment, he says, knowing then they would betray me, I immediately left my hiding place and was pursued almost incessantly until I was taken a fortnight afterwards by Mr. Benjamin Phipps. After Turner was captured on October 30th in Southampton, Virginia, he was transported to Jerusalem, where he was confined to jail to await trial. During the period of incarceration, Turner was, according to one newspaper, quite communicative, and one near-to-do lawyer, Thomas R. Gray, near-do-well lawyer Thomas Gray approached Turner with a proposal to publish Turner's confessions. According to Gray, Turner agreed, and Gray interviewed him as Turner awaited trial. On Saturday, November 5th, Southampton's most famous resident was tried in a case with a certain outcome. According to Gray's account of the sentencing, Jeremiah Cobb, the presiding magistrate, delivered the sentence of the court. The evidence before us, he said, leaves us not a shadow of doubt, but your hands were often imbrued in the blood of the innocent. Your own confession tells us that they were stained with the blood of a master. In your own language, quote, too indulgent. Could I stop here, your crime would be sufficiently aggravated. But the original contriver of a plan, deep and deadly, one that can never be effected, you managed so far to put it in execution as to deprive us, many of our most valuable citizens. And this was done when they were asleep and defenseless under circumstances shocking to humanity. And while upon this part of the subject, I cannot but call your attention to the poor, misguided wretches who have gone before you. They are not few in number. They were your bosom associates, and the blood of all cries aloud and calls upon you as the author of their misfortunes. Yes, you forced them, unprepared, from time to eternity. Borne down by this load of guilt, your only justification is you were led away by fanaticism. If this is true for my soul, I pity you. And while you have my sympathies, I am, nevertheless, called upon to pass your sentence of the court. The time between this and your execution will be necessarily very short, and your only hope must be in another world. The judgment of the court is that you be taken hence to the jail from whence you came, thence to the place of execution, and on Friday night next, between the hours of 10 and 2, be hung by the neck until you are dead, dead, dead. And may the Lord have mercy on your soul. Thomas R. Gray did not stick around the 6 days he would have needed to wait to attend Turner's execution. Instead, while Turner waited in jail, Gray went to Washington, D.C., where he presented the text to establish copyright, and then went to Baltimore, where he found a publisher for the text. This document, The Confessions of Nat Turner, is one of the most important, and I think one of the most problematic texts used by historians who study slavery. And I think that there's a single line from this text that I want to draw your attention to and explore with you this afternoon. According to Thomas R. Gray, Turner described his relationship to the man he called his master in this way. Quote, since the commencement of 1830, I have been living with Mr. Joseph Travis, who was to me a kind master and placed the greatest confidence in me. In fact, I had no cause to complain of his treatment to me. Let's think about that again. Kind master, greatest confidence, no cause to complain. And these are astounding quotes. And these phrases may even be more provocative to modern ears than they were when they were written. Calling someone a kind master strikes some today as oxymoronic as nice rapist. Just doesn't make sense. And there is something deeply unsettling about these phrases. It's my task today to help us think about how we can think about these comments. What was going on? What's behind the story where it appears Nat Turner says kind master, that Joseph Travis was his kind master? Now, to do this, I first want to start out by discussing how we think about this source. Now, there's obviously three ways we can think about the source. The first one is Turner is lying, right? Turner said it, but he didn't mean it, okay? Second possibility, Gray is lying, okay? Maybe Turner did never say it, and Gray's putting those words in his mouth. The third possibility is, of course, that Nat Turner did say it, and Thomas R. Gray recorded it reliably. I'll take those in turn. Was it a lie by Turner? Clearly, it is possible that Turner said these words or something to these effect, but did not mean them. There's nothing impossible about this. And in fact, this was a practice described by other slaves who escaped slavery and reflected on their experience in the institution. And let me give an example from an escaped slave that many of you know who discussed this very question, talking about the issue of the, quote, kind master in his narrative. Frederick Douglass, a slave also from the Chesapeake region, although Maryland, not Virginia, who was a rough contemporary, a little younger than Nat Turner, just said this in his first narrative. Slaves, when inquired as to their condition of the character of their masters, almost universally say they are contented and that their masters are kind. The slaveholders have been known to send in spies among their slaves to ascertain their feelings, their views and feelings in regard to their condition. The frequency of this had the effect to establish among the slaves the maxim that a still tongue makes a wise head. They suppress the truth rather than take the consequence of telling it, and in so doing prove themselves part of the human family. If they have anything to say of their masters, it is generally in their master's favor. And I have been frequently asked, when a slave, if I had a kind master. And I do not remember ever to have given a negative answer. So clearly some slaves did this. Am I a kind master? Yes, you are. Because if you say no, what happens? You get beaten. Okay? So could he have said this? Well, I think this is certainly something that some slaves did, but I don't think it's what Nat Turner did. And I want to give you three reasons why. First, the dynamic. The reason that Frederick Douglass says, and the reason that makes sense, that most slaves would suppress the truth, is that they'd rather than lie than, quote, take the consequences of telling the truth. Again, it makes perfect sense. But this makes sense for a slave who's asked by a white man if his master feeds him enough or treats him well. And in fact, in Frederick Douglass's narrative, he tells the story of a slave who has an owner who's so rich, he doesn't recognize the slave, and the slave doesn't recognize him. He sees him out on the road one day, and he says, how is your master? Who's your master? And it turns out to be him. He says, how is your master? Does he give you enough? Does he work you hard? He's all right, but he doesn't give us enough food. And the master, hearing him complain, later goes around and finds out who he was. He says, well, if he's unhappy with me, I'll sell him. And so that's what he did. So it's very dangerous for people, for slaves to be honest with slaveholders. But this does not apply to Nat Turner. By the time that Nat Turner is in jail, it is perfectly clear that, one, Turner's not going to be lynched, because that was a possibility before he got put in the jail. And it's as clear that Turner is going to be sentenced to die. Everyone knows that. His trial is purely show. Everyone knows what the outcome of his trial is going to be. There's no doubt. So the dynamic does not require him to lie to try to save his skin, because there's nothing he could say that would really change his fate one way or the other. Second, Turner and deference. The confessions themselves make clear that Turner was not playing the defer to the white man game. And I want to consider a couple moments, one at the trial and one when he was being interviewed by Gray. According to Gray's description of the trial, Turner at the trial, upon arraignment, completed not guilty, saying to his counsel that he did not feel so. He was not someone who was apologetic about this. Gray observed while he was in the, while Turner was telling him the confessions, that Gray made, that Turner made no attempt to exculpate himself, but frankly acknowledges his full participation in all and guilt, in all the guilt of the transaction. Likewise, when Turner stopped, when Gray stopped Turner and asked him if he was ready to recognize that this was a bad idea, it shouldn't have happened. God really hadn't called him to revolt. Turner's response is remarkable. He doesn't say, you're right. You know, this obviously didn't work. He didn't say, well, maybe, maybe not. He's going in jail. We don't have a lot on this, but he's going through some spiritual crisis here, right? He thought God called him to revolt, and then the revolt fails. But it's not that deep a spiritual crisis, and he still thinks that God had called him to do this. And he didn't think the result of the revolt was necessarily proof that God hadn't called him. And his response was, I think, perfect and not deferential. When Gray asked him, do you not find yourself mistaken? Turner responded, was not Christ crucified? Turner was not simply telling the whites what they wanted to hear. Finally, was Turner being cagey? This is one that no one's really examined thoroughly. You know, was he hiding stuff? And I think my sense is that there are certain things he's hiding, especially my guess. I obviously don't have evidence because he's hiding it. But one of the reasons why his wife is not mentioned and his kid is not mentioned in the confessions is because I think, well, one idea is that it's dangerous. He doesn't want to associate them with this. He doesn't want them to get in trouble for what he did. But Turner was not especially cagey in the jail. And we have one episode that tells us this. When Turner was jailed, he was not alone. All the other conspirators had been tried and sentenced. Some of them had been executed. Some whose sentences were commuted were sent away, and the ones who were found not guilty were released. All the slave trials were over. But free blacks had more rights in Virginia law. And so they were being held for a formal court hearing in the spring. So there was a handful of free blacks who were assumed to be involved in the revolt who were waiting in jail for their trial, which actually probably worked out, in my suspicion is it worked out for the free blacks. There were four free blacks awaiting trial, and three of them were eventually let off. And one was convicted. And one of the guys who was let off, we have very good evidence that he was involved in this. Great story about him. But anyway, so Turner goes to jail and these other free blacks are there. And while in jail, and while there's a newspaper reporter who's taking this down, there was a small group, and one of the visitors asked Turner if he had done this for money. Had you gone out and done this revolt for money? When one of the visitors asked this, he denied it, and he turned, and this is the newspaper report, he turned to one of the other prisoners, a free Negro, who stands over for further trial, and said to him, you know money was not my object. Now, of course, I just wish I got to see the response of the free Negro, Thomas Hathcock is one of the guy's names. You know I wasn't doing it. How do I know that? I wasn't with you. Remember? Remember? I wasn't with you at all. I don't know what you're talking about. Clearly, Nat Turner was not hiding the fact that this man had known him. And even though the question clearly revealed to the whites that this free black was somehow in on the revolt. So I don't think we're going to sit there and say Turner is lying. But that's not the objection most historians have raised. The objection most historians have raised is that it's a lie by Gray. Most historians have not suspected Turner of lying, but they have been suspicious of Thomas Gray. Was he doing what he said he was doing and really recording Turner's words carefully? At first blush, of course, this quote is exactly the quote that makes us think maybe he was putting words in Turner's mouth. Now, I have two reasons not to believe this, and I don't want to go into these too much, but First, the argument for this being a lie strikes me as radically speculative. One of the points that historians and others make when they look at it is they say the language doesn't sound like the language Turner would use. And one word that they pick out is enthusiasm. Enthusiasm was sort of a word that was not something that we wanted to have associated with your religion in 1830. And it's like, okay, and how do you know Nat Turner didn't want to associate enthusiasm with his religion? It's very speculative. There's also an argument that Gray did it for the money. Gray was out, he was broke, and actually as you trace his trajectory, he's gonna end up, at this point, a couple weeks after the revolt, the man who writes down his confessions gets disinherited by his father. And the reason I think he gets disinherited by his father is because he's so far in debt that if his father had left him anything, there would be people who would collect all that money. So instead of giving it to his father, his son, he gave it to his granddaughter, Thomas R. Gray's daughter. So he wants money. Now, yeah, he wants money, but does this necessarily mean that it's going to change the form? Again, you could change the form if you want money, or you could not. The final one is that the word choice sounds too sophisticated. And this one, again, strikes me as very speculative. How many years of schooling did Lincoln have? One, right? But he knew his Bible, and he knew his Shakespeare, and he had a great vocabulary. Reading the Bible can do wonders for one's vocabulary. And so it's, again, a dangerous game to say that this is the kind of word a slave should be using, especially a slave who is obviously literate, obviously intelligent. Now, my own close reading of the text, focusing on things outside of this section, has convinced me that Gray was fairly reliable. He did, I believe, as he say, write this down while he interviewed him. And the reason I think this is because he interjected when he was interviewing, and he'd occasionally ask questions or make comments, and he'd put those in parentheses, which is really fortunate for us. And then later, he put something in a footnote. And the question is, why does it appear in a footnote when all the other interjections are in parentheses? And my argument is the parentheses were put in as he went along. And then when he came back to review this with Nat Turner, as he says he did, that was the moment he put this comment, and it went on the bottom of the page because there was no room in the middle. It also preserves a different perspective. Gray has a different perspective than Turner. Turner, for example, sees his learning to read as a miracle, as a sign from God. For Gray, how he learned to read was simple. It was taught by his parents. Even at the Battle of Parker's Field, they have a very different perspective. Turner, till he died, believed that they had killed some whites in their first battle. And Gray wants to make it clear that they didn't. But he didn't make it clear in a way that would silence Turner. He let Turner make his mistake and then in parentheses added his comments. So when I read the text, I see that it looks like something that was put together quickly, and it did preserve Turner's voice, which is exactly what the sources at the time period say. Now, of course, Gray himself says he published these confessions with little or no variation from his own words. So he knew he was supposed to be treating it verbatim, even if obviously as the author he could. But other people at the time thought the same thing. A letter that appeared in the newspaper a few days after Turner's trial said, "I intended to enter into further particulars and indeed given you a detailed statement of his, Turner's, confession. But I understand a gentleman is engaged in taking them down verbatim from his lips with a view of gratifying public curiosity." So look at these things. My sense is that Gray actually did what he says he did. But this leads me to the third and the final and the most important reason to think that Turner did say something like kind master, is that kind master was a category that slaves had in their heads and they used. For example, Frederick Douglass, who suggested that kind master could be a lie, at other times describes the category, albeit not a category that means what the slaveholders wanted it to mean. When describing his mother, Douglas says, she was a field hand, and whipping is the penalty of not being in the field at sunrise, unless a slave has special permission from his or her master to the contrary, a permission which they seldom get. And one that gives it to him gives the proud name of being a kind master. So if you give permission for your slave to travel at night and not have to be in the field right at sunrise, that's a kind master. Frederick Douglass was not alone in using this term. Harriet Jacobs describes her kind mistress. Solomon Northrop uses the term for his master. So did many other slaves. Kind master was a category people used. So now, in the remainder of the time, I want to talk about what it means and how it's posed a problem for popular understandings of slavery. While I think the term kind master was used to describe, Turner used this term to describe the first person that he killed, I want to talk about how the phrase can be misused and look at the historical use of kind master. The thing I think we need to be careful for is not to assume that kind master is then used to justify slavery. One of the reasons that people find the phrase so obnoxious is because these comments have been used by people to justify slavery. And academic historians like myself are not above such dreck as much as we'd like to think so. We have a terrible tradition of generalizing from such evidence. The first academic history of Nat Turner's Revolt, written by William Sidney Drury in 1900, uses similar terms. Never in the history of slavery, he contended, was there less danger to the owners, more contentment among the slaves, fewer runaways, and greater advantages, social, financial, and political, gained from this institution. Given this view of slavery, Drury obviously saw no problem with the kind owner. He saw the kind owner as the norm, and he probably knew enough to know there were sadistic owners, but he saw them as exceptional. This view of slavery as a benign institution run by good people had incredible reach beyond the academy, especially through the new media of movies. For those familiar with the old movies, think of The Original Birth of a Nation or Gone with the Wind. How many of you guys have seen The Original Birth of a Nation? Several. How many, the old Gone with the Wind? Okay, more. This is, again, the plantation myth. But the efforts to justify slavery by looking for kind masters did not coincide with the emergence of the Dunning School. It was one of the ways that Southerners and their allies had defended themselves from the attacks of abolitionists. And I had a student last semester write an interesting paper on anti-slavery novels that appeared in response to Uncle Tom's Cabin. This view can also be seen in the work of people like Nehemiah Adams, who traveled to the South accompanying an invalid trying to escape a northern winter. His 1854 book, A South Side View of Slavery, describes the slaves that he finds in positive terms. So positive terms, in fact, that he's embarrassed by his work. How to say enough of the preconceived notions respecting slavery, he writes, so as to compare subsequent impressions with them, and yet not enough to give the Southern friends room to exult and say that we all have false and exaggerated notions about slavery? That's somewhat difficult, Nehemiah Adams persists. Perhaps the most memorable comment from his trip occurred when Nehemiah Adams, who was a preacher, encountered a slave in the woods at a religious ceremony and asked him whether the slave would like to be free. Twisting the old withes of a grapevine around the ends of a rail and mending a fence, he thought a moment, turned his face to me, while he had a rail, half tied in its place, and emphasized his words with motions of his head. He replied, each word being deliberately separated from the rest, "I want to be free from my sins. That's all my burden, and if I can get that, the balance of the rest may go for me." We were in the woods alone, and I had spoken of heaven, and he feared he should never see that happy place. I spoke of pardon through Christ, and his hopes revived. He promised that he would look to Christ alone for salvation. But how can someone sympathetic to the slaveholder's cause, one can see how someone sympathetic to the slaveholder's cause would love this book. But it's much it's not much harder to imagine how an opponent of slaveholders would respond to this. I'll let Harriet Jacobs make the case. Harriet Jacobs was a runaway slave from North Carolina who described her book, her experiences in a book called Instance in the Life of a Slave Girl. And this was her rebuttal. A clergyman who goes to the South for the first time usually has some feelings, however vague, that slavery is wrong. The slaveholder suspects this and plays his game accordingly. He makes himself as agreeable as possible, talks on theology and other topics. The reverend gentleman is asked to invoke a blessing on the table loaded with luxuries. After dinner, he walks around the premises and sees the beautiful groves and flowering vines and the comfortable huts of the favored household slaves. The southerner invites him to talk with these slaves. He asks them if they want to be free, and they say, "Oh, no, massa." This is sufficient to satisfy him, and he comes home to publish a South Side view of slavery and to complain of the exaggerations of the abolitionist. He assures people that he has been South and seen slavery for himself, that it is a beautiful patriarchal institution, and that the slaves don't want their freedom, that they have hallelujah meetings and other religious privileges. What does he know of the other half? What does he know of the half-starved wretches toiling from dawn till dark on the plantations, of mothers shrieking for their children, torn from their arms by slave traders, of young girls dragged down into the moral filth, of pools of blood around the whipping post, of hounds trained to tear human flesh, of men screwed into cotton gins to die? The slaveholders showed him none of these things, and the slaves dared not tell of them if he had asked. Jacobs does not give an inch to anyone who wants to generalize from the idea of a kind master. But she doesn't back away from the idea, which she uses herself. For one thing, Harriet Jacobs' litany of the most awful problems that people faced under slavery actually makes the kind master line more understandable. Those who leave slaves and cotton gins to die are not kind masters. It might not be a high bar, but a kind master had to clear that bar, and several did, even in Harriet Jacobs' own account. Perhaps the scene where this becomes most clear is in the chapter, actually, that appeared immediately before the one where Jacobs responded to Nehemiah Adams's book. She wrote about what happened in response to Nat Turner's revolt in Edenton, North Carolina, where she lived, about 60 miles away from where the revolt had taken place. She describes a period of persecution of many slaves by whites, and especially by the, quote, country bullies and the poor whites. Jacobs herself knew nothing annoyed them so much as to see colored people living in comfort and respectability. So I made arrangements for them with especial care. I arranged everything in my grandmother's house as neatly as possible. I put white quilts on the beds and decorated some of the rooms with flowers. And I just love this scene. She knows that nothing pisses people off as much, poor whites, as to see successful blacks. So what did she do? She put flowers out. She made her beds. Everything looked perfect. Now, why did she act so provocatively? I mean, she knows that this is going to drive the people, the whites who come into their house looking for guns and such, it's going to drive them crazy. Why did she do it? According to her account, she entertained no positive fears about our household because we were in the midst of white families who would protect us. As the tensions between Jacobs and the whites who were searching her house increased, Jacobs, quote, saw a white gentleman friendly to us, and I called to him and asked to have the goodness, him to have the goodness to come in and stay till the search was over. He readily complied. My grandmother had a large trunk of bedding and tablecloths, and when that was opened, there was a great shout of surprise. And as one exclaimed, "Where did damned niggers get all dis sheet and tablecloth?" Excuse my vernacular. My grandmother, emboldened by the presence of our white protector, said, "You may be sure we didn't pilfer them from your houses." Now, this is a great moment in antebellum literature, and it was, not just because it's a subversive moment where Harriet Jacobs feels that she's got enough power to stand up and her grandmother have enough power to stand up to these people who are coming into the house. And it's not only subversive in the moment that it's taking the minstrel idea and flipping on its head. Remember, who's speaking vernacular in that piece? It's the white people. So it's a black author writing white voices in vernacular. But what made this all possible was that she made the distinction in her head between the white slaveholders who would protect her after a slave revolt and those slaveholders who were leaders of the mobs. While the kind master has posed problems historically, I think it poses a different kind of problem today, which connects to our inability to imagine a kind master. To get to this, I'm going to look at a different account, a slave account that described a kind master that's made its way onto the big screen. In Solomon Northrop's 12 Years a Slave, which many of you have seen, how many of you guys have seen 12 Years a Slave? Not that many. It's a good flick. It won Best Picture, right? Go see it. It's available. I think this movie, which is regarded by many historians as one of the most accurate Hollywood movies ever made, struggled with this very concept of the kind master. And we can see this in the interpretation of William Ford, the man played by Benedict Cumberbatch, or as my daughter says, Sherlock. According to the movie, Ford is a Christian master, but his Christianity is emptied of any content as he preaches to his slaves about the children, even as he's oblivious to how Eliza, one of his new slaves, weeps for the loss of her children. I've just got a brief scene to show you here.
You make no sounds, but will you ever let them go in your heart?
They are as my flesh.
Then who is distressed? Do I upset the master and the mistress? Do you care less about my loss than their well-being?
Master Ford is a decent man.
He is a slaver.
Under the circumstances.
Under the circumstances, he's a slaver. But you truckle at his boot.
No.
You luxuriate in his favor.
I survive. I will not fall into despair. I will offer up my talents to Master Ford. I will keep myself hardy till freedom is opportune.
Oh, Ford is your opportunity. You think he does not know that you are more than you suggest. But he does nothing for you, nothing. You are no better than prized livestock. Call for him, call, tell him of your previous circumstances and see what it earns you, Solomon. So you settle into your role as Platt then?
My back is thick with scars for protesting my freedom. Do not accuse me.
I accuse you of nothing. I cannot accuse. I have done dishonorable things to survive, and for all of them, I have ended up here. No better than if I had stood up for myself. God, forgive me. Solomon, let me weep for my children.
Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name,
I cannot have that kind of depression about.
But whoso shall offend one of these little ones, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he were drowned in the depth of the sea. Amen.
So, so here's Ford. Ford is a man who preaches Christianity, but he's oblivious. He's preaching about the children, about how we have to be like the children. Of course, reminding Eliza of her children, which she's separated from and will never see again. He's completely oblivious, and his wife is sitting completely unsympathetic. Now, this contrasts explicitly with what Northrop says about Ford. And I'm going to read, this is from Solomon Northrop's own book. In many northern minds, perhaps, the idea of a man holding his brothers in servitude in the traffic of human flesh may seem altogether incompatible with their conceptions of a moral or religious life. They are led to despise and extricate the whole class of slaveholders indiscriminately. But I was sometimes his slave, and I had the opportunity of learning well his character and disposition. And it is but simple justice to him when I say, in my opinion, there was never a more kind, noble, candid, Christian man than William Ford. popular culture really can't get its head around this phrase, kind master. It's something that Birth of a Nation struggles with as well. This idea, how do we deal with kind master? Well, I think that we should get our heads around kind master. And we have to do it in such a way that doesn't get us to fall into the trap of trying to use kind master to justify slavery. Now, obviously, I think we can do this, although I do hesitate on one fact. In 1861, America had 4 million slaves, okay, when the Civil War started. How many slaves are in the world today? Does anyone know the estimates? 30 million are the ones I hear, but it's certainly a range, so 20 would be. There's a lot of slaves in the world today. In many ways, we think of slavery as something that's gone by, and it really hasn't. And so I wouldn't want to not, you know, oh, but they're kind masters, and not have an abolitionist movement. I think, you know, this is one of the terrible things in our world that we really are oblivious to. But I don't think that looking at slaves using the phrase kind master in the past is going to make us turn against abolition. In fact, I think the more we think about slavery seriously, I think the more likely we're to be abolitionists today. But what do we gain by using kind master? And I think that there's three brief things, and then we'll open it up. First, I think we have a renewed appreciation for the view of the people who are enslaved. Steve McQueen, the director, who plays Eliza's crying over Master Ford's sermon, essentially silences Northrop's judgment of his master. He called him the best Christian he knew. He knew it. He, you know, this was an informed statement made by Solomon Northrop. But that goes away. We can't have that. And that's an important thing. It's especially important, I think, with Nat Turner. One of the ways I think Birth of a Nation struggles is it makes the story of Nat Turner something of a revenge story. Okay, it's a story about how Nat Turner is taking revenge against the rape of his wife and his best friend's wife. Okay, and that's certainly understandable. But I think when Nat Turner is saying, I had a kind master, he's challenging us, his readers, Thomas Gray and everyone else, to think about the slave revolt as more than just a response to a signal indignity. I think he's trying to say it's a bigger thing. I think, again, we're silencing him by saying it's a response to a specific indignity. He's attacking the system of slavery itself. Second, I think that there's a lack of real understanding of what slavery is like because of the way we misunderstand the past, not accepting things like kind master. For example, Birth of a Nation, the recent movie about the Nat Turner Revolt, is essentially the same as Django Unchained, in presuming that the entire black community, in each movie there's one Uncle Tom excepted, understands that the revolters are right. But in part, because slaves have this concept of kind masters, slaves are really divided about the revolt. Slave resistance is a lot harder than people understand. If everyone understands that slavery is wrong and it should be fought at every moment, which is sort of how we want to think about slavery, I don't think we really get into the experience of slaves who lived in slavery. The kind master created something that was very popular in academic circles 30 or 40 years ago, and isn't as popular today, certainly not in slave studies, which is what I work on, the idea of false consciousness. It's a Marxian idea. But there's an idea that slaves really understand what they should do. But if you look at the responses to Nat Turner's revolt, there's a lot of confusion, and there's a lot of people divided. The free black who I mentioned earlier, Thomas Hathcock, some people came in and said, there's a slave revolt going on and we're supposed to join. What should we do? He said, you're supposed to join. Go join. And then he said, well, actually, wait a second. He turns to his wife and basically says, and this is how I'm interpreting it, get me a sandwich. I'm going with them. And his wife turns to him and goes, are you insane? Don't do it. You're going to die. And so here there's deep divisions in the black community as they're trying to figure out, are we supposed to do this? And unless we start moving to a more nuanced understanding of the black community, we'll never understand, I think, really the power of slavery. Finally, the lessons of the past. I think writing what I would call a Manichaean account of the oppression of slavery, where slave ownership immediately makes one bad, makes slavery an institution that's odd. It's unusual. I mean, today, I don't think we think, whatever the problems are in the world, and I think that there's a way in which we've become more polarized in the last 5 or 10 or 15, 20 years, and so it's less and less true. But there's a way in which we don't see people on the other side as bad, which makes it very hard to take the lessons from slavery to our world. If you want to argue, for example, that the Black Lives Matter movement has connections to slavery, and I believe it really does. If you're going to argue that, one thing that some person can respond is saying, well, that's not, we don't live in a world like slavery, right? We got Barack Obama as president or something like that. You know, you can sit there and say, that's such an unusual system, it's such an inhumane system, that whatever the oppressions are in the world today seem different. And I want to encourage us to think about, no, actually, the oppressions in the world today are connected to the world of slavery, and the stories of slavery do connect to the way we should think about the oppressions that continue in the world today. It's a little messier than creating cartoon versions of history or creating cartoon versions of your opponents, which I think is happening more and more in the public discourse today. But I think it's the most fruitful way to go, in a way that a new direction in slave studies can help us move. All right, with that, we're going to have a reception shortly afterwards, but I can open up to questions for a couple minutes.
Student questions, if possible, first.
What's that?
Yeah, I just put it on. So, are there any students that we can start with? Great way to impress your professors. My students know I'll wait you out. To come back to you. I expect some student questions.
Well, I'm not enrolled here, but I'm a lifelong student.
It's a good kind.
Getting back to Gray,
right.
I'm thinking about either his motivation or even literary ability to reframe what Turner said. It seems like is going to come up with a more sellable product by contriving it versus accurately reporting it.
I think the time frame of Gray is really important. Turner makes his way into, arrives in Jerusalem on October 31st, and he meets with Gray for the first time on November 1st or November 2nd. This is a Monday or Tuesday. Gray, I believe, and says, has this thing written by Thursday? So it's written really quickly. And he claims that it is read at the trials on Saturday. Okay, so he arrives in town Sunday night. It's being read at the trials on Saturday. And I'm not sure of that, but I think that's probably right. So it's a really, really quick job. And one of the things that becomes one of the arguments, and I'm not the first one to make this argument, but another historian who's looked at this, says one of the things that's really impressive is he keeps track of his point of view. There's stuff that Gray wants to tell us about, you know, tragic killings and such, that Nat Turner didn't see. And those never make it into the confessions, right? So he's really, really working quickly. Now, I mean, if you read As I Lay Dying, Professor Barber, how quickly was that written? That was written like in no time. Yeah, it was written in 6 weeks. So, I mean, obviously, if you're a great genius like Faulkner, you can do something like that. It seems to me pretty doubtful that's certainly not the easiest explanation for how he kept true to Turner's perspective. He created a fictional Turner and then kept it in line. No, it seems likely that he just did what he said, which was take Turner's confessions down. And it's hard to do because there's all these lines in Turner's confessions that are troubling to us, and they're so much easier to dismiss and say, well, that's gray. And that's what we've been doing, is we've been throwing out the stuff that we don't want. And I think I want to challenge us to think about these awkward and uncomfortable moments in the confessions. He went up to a firm in Baltimore. Right.
The idea is he had this in mind all along.
No. This is something that appeared, they're like, you can do this. And I think, actually, Gray had real financial difficulties. Everyone knew his father had just disinherited him. They knew he was in trouble. And so I don't know this, but my suspicion is they sort of threw it to him and said, maybe you can make some money doing this. You know, you take it down, you take it up. And he hoped to make a great deal of money, but there's no sign that he ever did. He was still very poor throughout.
Your talk raises a lot of very fascinating sociological and even theological issues, but I'm going to try just a bit of ordinary language philosophy. I don't have any problem with the expression of kind master. It means a master who is kind as masters go. I mean, there are lots and lots and lots of expressions. Some of them, I fear, terribly politically incorrect. But in any case, you're okay of your kind when your kind is despicable, even. Once you see that bit of language philosophy, a lot of the problems seem to, in the good old-fashioned words of Wittgenstein, dissolve.
I think that there's something to be said for that. You might be less sensitive to some of the problems of kind master than someone else might be. I mean, this is the kind of stuff that people have heard academics use to justify slavery for a long time. So it is, I think there is a fingernails on the chalkboard effect. But the other thing is, I mean, you can say it's fine and good and whatever and accept it, but it's easy to read through it and ignore it, even in 12 years of, I mean, this is what I was showing you in 12 years of slave. You know, he read kind master. He said, well, but that's not really a kind master. But in Solomon Northrop's terms are clearly not just saying he's a kind master, a person who didn't put me in a cotton gin and leave me to die. He said he was a kind master, the most Christian person I'd ever met. I was actually at a party in New York, and one of the marketing people for my book comes out and says, you know, I say, you know, I pointed this out to him. I said, he says he's as good as a Christian. The guy says, well, you know Christians. Which is one way to interpret it, but I don't think it's the way Solomon Northrop meant it. I think Solomon Northrop meant it as very high praise. Jim? Right. Mm-mm. I went quickly and skipped a couple steps, but basically my argument is the way we view slavery, the historians, the revisionist way of reviewing slavery, the bad slavery is bad, which emerged hand in hand with the civil rights movement, looks at slavery as, say, an original sin, as this really exceptional thing that's really weird and bad, okay? And that was really useful in 1965, because what was the thing they were arguing against? a really unusual, weird, odd, and bad system of segregation, right? So painting the South as this weird place that has this unusual and bad institution was very helpful for the argument of the civil rights movement. I don't think that the targets that we're thinking about today, the issues in front of us today, are bad in the same sort of, we can't make them weird in the same sort of way. Whatever you think the problem is, if you think it's global warming, or if you think it's the meat producers, or if you think it's war, or if you think it's capitalism, whatever you think it is, think of poverty, all these different issues out there. If you make them, they don't seem exceptional in the same way, and they can't be made as unusual and as peculiar. If slavery is a peculiar institution, which is another term from the scholarship of the age, then it's really hard to sort of see how it applies to our lives. I mean, when you sit there and you meet these people who are doing these things, we don't immediately think, wow, these people are so different and so bad. I mean, at least I hope that's not what you think when you meet these people. And I think that one of the things that we're doing wrong in society right now is moving into a sort of cartoonish understanding of our opponents, and partly because of the way we portray each other on the left and on the right.
The next question will be from students, so you guys have been warned. No, after yours. Good. I'm putting that
excellent
on the spot.
Good. I definitely agree with the point that you make about, right, not taking these historical, I want to say historical evils, I don't want to let go of that,
right,
but treating them as exceptional in a way that prevents us from connecting them to problems that we might be facing now. But I guess it seems to me there's still a layer of complexity there that I'm not quite sure how, from these examples, we get around. Because if we take on board the version of Kind Master that makes good on Northrop's reading, where we imagine that it's praise to call someone the finest example of a Christian, right? So if we take that view, then what happens when we apply the lessons of slavery to, right, or of, you know, American slavery to the forms of injustice, including, you know, slavery elsewhere in the world today, to ourselves? And we think, well, yeah, so there are some evil institutions that are still out there, just like there were then, but, you know, just like Northrop's master, I can be a perfectly good person despite, as long as, you know, in my sort of personal relations, I'm, right, good enough by the sort of prevailing standards, and I'm not one of the worst people, I can be a perfectly good person then. And it looks like if that's the lesson we lose, then, right, we have this institutional critique, but I think we've lost something about thinking about individual responsibility for being part of those institutions.
Yeah, no, I mean, you're right. We need to think, I guess one of the things, I mean, there's a sense in which there's a desire to make, you know, Jim brought up the Holocaust, and the Holocaust and slavery are the sort of the two examples that we all get to agree are bad, which is great. But the problem is we don't agree, everyone else doesn't agree about any of the issues in front of us today as bad. And that's one of the problems. And so I want to sort of try to return that. That doesn't mean that you don't take a side on slavery. And it doesn't mean that Solomon Northrop thinks, well, slavery is a great system. I mean, that's not his point. But his point is he understands the way he looks at his master. He's open to a different understanding of his master than we have. And I think that understanding of the master is needed to understand slavery, and it's needed to make slavery relevant today. I think because we don't have these systems where everyone agrees that institution is really so terrible and awful, and anyone who's associated with it is, horrible, horrible person or something like that. That's not the analogy that really fits to today. And what we always want to do is we want to sit there and take slavery and make something today like slavery. And I think that's the wrong way to go, because, you know, we're trying to make it into a not sophisticated issue. And most of the issues that we're debating are sophisticated, and we have to recognize that.
Yeah. All right, there we go.
So I'm very interested in the whole belief that Nat Turner had, that he was called by God to start this revolt, and that he held that belief to the very end, he told Gray, correct, that he still believed. So do you think that at his death, Nat Turner was content with the revolt? Was it really a failure in his eyes? What's the legacy of the revolt?
Yeah, he knew, this is one of the things I think that's clear, is he understood that the revolt, he wasn't crazy. He knew the revolt was likely to fail. He actually, I think, one of the things I try to argue in my book is that he had a clear understanding of the dynamics of the black community. He wasn't surprised that the black community didn't rise. I mean, they were originally scheduled to begin the revolt on July 4th, right? Great day to begin a revolt. But they said, he got worried and he got sick. And the reason he's worried is because they couldn't come up with any plan that sounded even plausible. Their ultimate plan was far-fetched and likely to fail, and they all knew that. They all knew that. They, you know, when Will comes up, he says, "Are you ready to join us? Are you ready to fight for freedom?" He goes, "Yeah." And, "Are you ready to die?" "Yeah." "Well, then you're okay, because that's what we're doing. We're probably going to die." And so he didn't know how this was part of God's plan, but he believed it was part of God's plan. And so, you know, Jesus gets crucified. You know, this, so he sees it like that. Just because you're doing something that God wants you to do doesn't mean that every day is going to be Palm Sunday and you're going to get a walk, go into Jerusalem, and everyone's going to praise you. You know, and he didn't really think that that was likely to be the outcome, because I don't think, and this is one of the things that a lot of the old historiography tries to paint him as somewhat crazy. And his decisions make sense given his premises. And that's, you know, and so, you know, I think you got to give him that. So everyone, and this is one of the things, Thomas R. Gray hates Turner, but he says, you know, this guy's a smart guy. I mean, coming up with a line about they crucified Jesus, that's a great line. You know, he just understands. He sees it a certain way. And, you know, so I think that Turner was, when he died, I think Turner was convinced that he was still doing what God had told him to do, and he was a martyr for God. When he went to his death, there are only two reports of what happened, but both accounts say that he died without complaint, and that he, in one of the accounts, he hurried the executioner onto his duty. He was not afraid to die. He was not scared. He was not, you know, so, and that would have been clearly something the whites would have said, oh, if he had been sorry, if he had been trying to get out of it and begging for, you know, that, but that didn't happen. Yes. You know, they say, judge not, lest you be judged. All we can see is what the evidence is, and so there's a lot of things that we don't know. But I certainly approach him when I write as a person who's trying to be serious. I don't want to dismiss him as, you know, on the terms that he's, you know, that he's laid out for himself. So I treat him, he claims to be a serious Christian, I treat him as such. How do you judge? I have no idea, and I don't want to. That's not a historian's job. In the back. That's the estimate. Yeah. A lot. This is one of the things. The face of slavery has changed, and a lot of slavery is in third world places. A lot of slavery is more. It's more female and more sex slave. I mean, that's where sex slaves. That's where slavery is today. It's. But you know, the estimates I've read, and you know, these are just estimates. It's in the tens of millions. It's, you know, 30 million is the estimate. That's a lot of slaves. That's a lot of slaves. Sophia.
Thank you for a really great talk. I have a question. I agree about the fact that trying to map on, like, the historical institution of slavery to contemporary slavery is quite difficult because it does look very different. But I'm wondering if you could expand on trying to think about, for example, the Black Lives Matter movement and its linkages to these, you know, fighting against these oppressive institutions, right? Because what we do know is that we can, even though we can't map on slavery historically to slavery today easily, we can trace the lineages of oppressive institutions throughout the U.S. history, right? So an innovation on slavery was Jim Crow. An innovation on Jim Crow was incarceration. And so there are multiple iterations of institutions to deny, for example, African Americans their freedom. So I'm wondering if you could talk about how we could think about, expand on how we could think about that.
That's exactly the point of this. I mean, what I'm trying to do is historicize slavery. Right, and one of my points is not that this whatever happened, you know, Travis was a great master or whatever, good, kind master. That meant all the other guys were great. I mean, slavery is different in Southampton than it is in Mississippi, and it's different in New England than it is in Virginia. I mean, and it's different in the 18th century than it is in the 19th century. There are these changes. So we think of slavery as this institution. And I think the way that you think about it, as there's sort of this racism and these oppressions that are transforming themselves in different ways, into new forms of slavery, or into different forms of oppression that are no longer called slavery, but seem awful. I mean, one of the things that I certainly try to emphasize in my African American history class is, you know, as, and I don't, you know, is the lynching state, you know, that in you know, from 1880 to 1920 or 1930, we're looking at something like 3 blacks being lynched a week in this country. It's insane. Well, why was it? That was a new way to enforce political control, okay? They didn't have to lynch their slaves. I mean, they occasionally did something that would look like lynching, but not very much, because slaves were too profitable. You didn't want to lynch your slaves. You wanted to avoid that as much as possible. So there's ways in which there's always these transformations of oppression and that take place. And I think that the other problem is, if you see slavery as sort of this uniquely bad institution, then you make a movie like Spielberg made, which is Lincoln. Remember, Lincoln won and everything's good. You know, because we killed that bad institution. But if you see slavery as being different forms of oppression happening in different ways with different kinds of people, and it's worse or better, then it's easy to see how we have this morphing continue, even the same morphing continuing even after the end of slavery. So, all right, well, I think I want to thank you all for coming and invite you to the reception that we're going to have in the Great Hall. So thanks again.